it will be very interesting to read for the exam point of view, and especially in the entrance point of view, because what we read, what we deal with public health dentistry, the entrance point of view is entirely different what you read in your public health in your UG curriculum. So Sobhan Peter, the textbook Sobhan Peter, does not need any introduction as far as it is a textbook which has been followed by everyone. Then apart from that, there is a textbook, some of you might be aware of it. It's a textbook by S.S. Hiramuth. It's a textbook of preventive and community dentistry. It's a very good book for some of the chapters like fluorides, preventive dentistry, and caries. It's a very must read, because from past 3 years, what has been observed in this specialty is the questions had been asking, many questions had been asking there from the chapter of fluorides. Last year, 2019, they had been asking many questions from fluorides. So it is a must read book when you're reading about fluoride, S.S. Hiramuth. Then you have a book called as K Park, that is a book for preventive and social medicine. It is a book followed for medical students. So you have some chapters, like selective chapters, like screening test, public health, then diseases, which is very important for that from book, that book. And lastly, for biostatistics, they ask some papers, they do ask little difficult aspect from biostatistics, example, problem solving. So for all the questions which has been asked so far in NEET exams, one of the basic book what you can follow is B.K. Mahajan. It is by an Indian author, very comprehensive book what you can read, which is you can read and understand the biostatistics. And it is a must read if you want to solve the problem solving exercises what you come across in your entrance exams. With this overview, I would like to, we'll be discussing a very short topic from epidemiology, and if time permits, one topic from biostatistics, as a very basic biostatistics in this session. So the reason why I took randomized controlled trials is the very reason NEET exam 2020, we had a question from randomized controlled trials. So I thought I will deal something with, we talk about randomized controlled trial in epidemiology. So randomized controlled trial, when we talk about randomized controlled trial, it is the most important epidemiological design or most important experimental design which is used to my voice is there any issues with my voice? Randomized controlled trials are most important experimental epidemiological designs which is used to check or test the effectiveness of any intervention. So intervention means that you are doing some experiments into study subjects. So the reason why it is called as randomized controlled trial and why it is a part of experimental studies, when you talk about any experimental study, as the word says, experimental study designs, you are doing some experiments or you are doing some intervention onto the patient. So you're doing directly inside the patient, when you do some procedures directly inside the patient, we call it as experimental study. Unlike your other study designs which you come across in your analytical studies, for example, your case control and cohort, or your cross-section in your observation studies, you don't intervene into the patient. That's to say, you're not doing any procedures inside the patient. So when you do some procedures inside the patient, when you're doing an intervention inside the patient, we call it as experimental study. And apart from randomized controlled trials, you have field trials and community trials, which are not very much concerned for us. The major difference between a randomized controlled trials or a community trials is, in randomized controlled trials, the individual is the point of study, or the unit of studies is the individual. The main focus or what you're studying is the individuals. Whereas in a community trials, as the word says, you're taking a larger community, a larger population, community intervention trials. Okay? So that is your randomized controlled trial, where you are doing some interventions, you're doing some experiments, or you're doing some procedures inside the patient. And it is considered as a gold standard. So out of all the study designs or all epidemiological studies, if you broadly classify the epidemiology, you have observational epidemiology and you have experimental epidemiology. As the word says, observing your population is known as observation. And doing some experiments is your RCTs, or randomized controlled trial. all your observation studies is different. The way it is different from randomized controlled trials or the experimental study is only most crucial part of the experiment or the procedures. In the observational studies, you are observing a population. Either you are describing them in terms of gender, age, or socioeconomic status, or you are trying to describe the disease or health status, what they have, what are the diseases they have, what is the cause of the disease, what is the etiology of the disease, or what are the factors responsible for the disease. So this comes under case control and follow. When it comes to randomized control trial, RCT, you're doing some procedures or you're doing some experiments. That is why it is called as gold standard. So you have something called as hierarchy of evidence. You have a hierarchy of evidence where you consider randomized control trials as the most important, as the topmost levels in all of the study designs. You can see in this, you can see there here, out of your cross-sectionals, your case controls and cohort, it is the randomized control trial which stands the highest. Forget about the meta-analysis and systematic reviews at this point of time, because that is a little different scenarios over there. So highest hierarchy is always meta-analysis, systematic review. But when you consider all your epidemiological designs, the most important or the most highest or strongest evidence is always for randomized controlled trial. That is the reason why it is called as the gold standard. Now let's go to the basic steps in conducting an RCT or randomized controlled trial. There are six basic steps. One is drawing up a protocol, selecting a reference and experimental population, randomization, manipulation, follow-up, and assessment. The most simple way to remember this six step is by a mnemonic called as DSR-MFA. So I remember is like DSLR camera has maximum focal adjustment. Yeah? So it is very, very easy to remember. All your steps has to be remembered with some mnemonics, because if you don't remember the mnemonics, everything will be so confused. So DSLR camera has maximum focal adjustment, DSR-MFA. Fine, so these are the steps. Let's go and see. Let's see what are the important steps. How do you go about doing an RCT? The first is drawing up a protocol. Yeah. So the very classic difference between other analytical study designs and conducting an RCT is the protocol. So all RCTs have a protocol, and you have to strictly adhere to the protocol. So the protocol has a set of aims and objectives, some questions to be answered. What are the criteria of selection, that is a study and control group, intervention, that is a procedure to be done, standardization, schedules, and evaluation. So let's take an example and go about with how you do conduct a randomized control trial. Yeah. So let me take, I'm doing a study. I'm doing my post-graduation in the Department of Periodontics. I'm doing my post-graduate. I'm just a hypothetical example. And so I want to study the effectiveness of clorhexidine in reduction of periodontitis. Yeah, this is my study. This is my research. I'm doing this study. So this is an intervention, because I'm administering chlorhexidine mouthwash into the patient. So I'm administering the procedure into the patient. So it becomes an experimental study. And so my aim will be to study the effectiveness of chlorhexidine on periodontitis. And then my objectives will be assessment of gingival conditions, assessment of periodontal, or et cetera, or gingival bacteria. I can have two, three, or four objectives. Right? Then what are the questions to be answered? What happens? What are the parameters to be considered? What happens to the periodontal conditions? What happened to the gingival? So all these aspects has to, what are the factors? What are the things to be answered when you conduct the study? That is questions to be answered. How do you select your study subject? What, on what basis you study them? For example, you're studying in a group of periodontal patients. Should they have, or should you avoid the patients who are having some systemic diseases like your diabetes, or if they are having any immunocompromised diseases? So this stands out to the criteria of selection. Then next comes the intervention, that is administering the chlorhexidine mouthwash. So we are taking an example of effectiveness of chlorhexidine on periodontitis. So we have an aim, we have an objective. Now we have a criteria of selecting your study subjects and control, then you do administer the mouthwash. Then you have something called a standardization. Yeah, standardization is a step where you do two procedures called as calibration and training. to train the investigator, because you need to know. For example, the same study, if you want to measure the pocket depth, so unless an antenna individual know how much is the probing pocket depth or how much is the cutoff limit of measuring a pocket 3 mm. If it doesn't know, if the investigator doesn't know how to measure, what are the instrument to measure, then it becomes a lot of errors do happen. So that is why you have to train the examiner. Similarly, calibration. Example of a calibrated probe is your CPI probe or WHO probe or a Williams periodontal probe. It means it has markings. So this procedure of using a calibrated instrument and training are called a standardization. So you have to standardize to make it more uniform. Before you start about your RCTs or experiment, you have to make it uniform such that errors doesn't happen. Then you have to schedule when, how, where to do these experiments. And finally, you evaluate it. So right from the first step to the last step has to be set, predetermined, and it has to be written in a protocol. So that is the classical difference between RCTs when compared to analytical study designs. And it has to be strictly followed. Now, what is a reference and experimental population? So once you have a protocol, you go for a reference population and an experimental population. The reference population is a population in which you extrapolate or generalize the results. Means to say, it is a population to which you want to actually relate the findings to. For example, I took a group of people, I did a study of chlorhexidine and found that I took almost 30 individuals, I administered chlorhexidine to them. And that was my study, right? I'm taking that as an example throughout. So I administered chlorhexidine. I found that periodontitis has significantly reduced. So I can make a generalized statement that chlorhexidine is effective in reducing periodontitis or gingivitis. So this can be again administered to every individual and marketed for public. So that is generalization. So to the population to which you generalize, it is called as a reference population. An experimental population is actually a part of reference population in which you do the procedure. Right? So you pick up a group of individuals. So when you pick up a group of patients from your hospital or from the college where you do your post-graduation, you pick up a group of individuals. They constitute a part of the reference. They represent a group from the larger population. And on this population which you have picked up for administering this chlorhexidine is called as your experimental population. I hope it is clear. So any part, if you have come up with any doubts or if you want me to repeat something, you can just comment on the chat box, always invited. Or if you want me to repeat something, you can just drop a message in the chat box. So that is your reference and experimental population. So once you're done with your reference and experimental, reference and experimental population, somebody has asked me to repeat. So reference population, the first thing to remember, it is the large population or to the population into which you are generalizing. Say, for example, I want to find the prevalence of dental caries in children. So I'll take a small group of people from one of the school. So once I find that the caries is high in this school children, or any particular same, name of the school is A, name school A. So that school is experimental population. And my findings will be generalized to the entire children, like the particular district or particular state. So that becomes your reference population. So to the population to which you're trying to generalize your findings are reference population, or the population to which you do a procedure is called as experimental population. Yeah, so you select both, right? So you have to identify what is your reference and what is your experimental population. So more importantly, your experimental population, because the experimental population has to be from your reference population. Otherwise, you cannot generalize. Next is the most important and most determining step in your randomized control trial, which is known as randomization. It is also called as heart of randomized control trial, HERT, heart of randomized control trial. It is a statistical procedure by which participants are allotted randomly into groups called study and control group. Yeah, as the word says, randomized control trial, you're randomly allocating subjects into two groups. Fine. So randomization is a process by which you are giving every individual an equal chance of being selected. That is, out of 20, if you are dividing them into 10, you are randomly calling each individual, means you are everybody out of this 20 has an equal chance of being selected either to the control or either to the case group. So that is the importance of, and that is the advantage of randomization. And it is the sole process of avoiding a bias called as selection bias. So you avoid a selection bias by doing randomization in RCTs. Most common bias in any type of study design is your selection bias. And RCT, you do avoid selection bias by a step called as randomization. There are many steps for doing randomization. One of the steps for doing randomization is the most common thing what we all do in our daily practice, speaking lots. If you want to divide among yourself, you write your names and make some lots and pick the lots randomly. Well, that is considered as a method for random allocation. Another method is called a table of random numbers. You can randomly allocate individuals into two different groups. And so this is randomization. Yes, you define, you set a protocol, then you select reference and target experimental population. My voice is, any problem with my voice? Okay, one second. Yeah, so randomization. One second, just hold on. Am I audible now? Hello, can you hear? Hello? Yeah. So manipulation means you're doing the same intervention, the procedure into the patient. So the example what we took was chlorhexidine mouthwash in periodontitis, right? So you're administering the chlorhexidine is known as manipulation. You're administering it into the patient is known as manipulation. So similar way, if it is a drug, or if it is a vaccine, or it is dietary, or if you're placing an implant, or if if you want to compare the efficacy, or you want to compare between different rotary instruments by cleaning and shaping. So that particular procedure is called as manipulation. So anything we are doing into the patient is called as manipulation or intervention. Next is follow-up. Once you're done with follow-up, so it is examination of the groups or the group of individuals at defined intervals of time under
under similar conditions in a very standard manner. That is, some studies require follow-up over a period of time, that is 1 month, 2 months, sometimes it will be 3 months or 6 months. It depends upon what you're studying. So follow-up simply means that you're trying to evaluate the subjects or to evaluate the individuals over a period of time, specified period of time of equal intervals. So for our example, when you're administering chlorhexidine in reduction of periodontitis, we have to evaluate them in 2 months or 3 months or after 6 months. So to see that at what interval this particular drug or particular mouthwash is effective in reducing the periodontitis. So that is the follow-up. And a last follow-up is called as attrition. You might have come across the word attrition in conservative. So here attrition is different. Many times they do ask questions on attrition. So attrition here is loss to follow-up. So a patient does not turn up to follow-up examination. First, you have administered them chlorhexidine. You recall the patient on third month. He did not follow up. He did not come on the third month. It is called as loss to follow-up. And the term is attrition. The reason, most common reasons for attrition are death, migration, and loss of interest. And last, you do assessment. You assess the outcome. Once you have completed your study, at the end of 3 months or 6 months, you have completed the study, you check for the outcome. The outcome can be two ways. Either it is a positive outcome as you decide, or it could be a negative outcome, which is undesirable. At times it could be undesirable. Sometimes it will be as a consequences or side effects. Whatever the outcome, you have to assess and evaluate it. In case of chlorhexidine and mouth periodontitis, the positive result is the reduction of periodontitis. Thereby, you can say that your experiment was successful in reducing, effective in reducing periodontitis. Whereas in some other examples, like you're administering antihypertensive drugs to a particular group of individuals, like a pregnant woman, there will be some side effects of the drugs. So that those can be recorded as negative results in your study or in your experiment. So both your positive and negative outcome has to be assessed. Clear? So these are the 6 steps in randomized controlled trial. Fine. So again, I'll repeat the steps. You start off with, I hope any doubts you have. You design a protocol. Clear? Then you select your reference and target, or reference and experimental population. And the most important step, which is your randomization. Then you do manipulation. Manipulation, clear? Then you do a manipulation, then follow-up and assessment. Fine. These are the most important, these are the 6 steps you do a randomized controlled trials. So our example was chlorhexidine periodontitis. You set a protocol, clear? You set a protocol by defining the aim, objective, standardization, what are the things to do, schedule and evaluation. Then you go about selecting the reference and your experimental population. You randomly allocate the individual, selected individuals into an experimental group, control group. You administer the chlorhexidine into them. You follow up of them over a period of time. Then you assess the outcome. Clear? So this is your randomized control trial. Now you have, we'll just see to two different study designs in your randomized control trial. One are called as concurrent parallel study designs. Another study design is called as crossover type of study designs. Clear? Concurrent study designs and crossover. Let's see the designs. So concurrent is your typical normal RCTs, where you divide the group of individuals randomly into exposed and unexposed. Two groups, observe them over a period of time, and you check for the outcome. This is by default the conventional RCTs, concurrent parallel designs. Clear? What two groups, one is the experimental and your control group. You administer, you give the intervention, you give the experiment to one group, whereas the other is not, intervention is not given. Then you finally observe them over a period of time and you check for the outcome. Next is another type of study design, where the first phase, it is almost same. You give the intervention to a particular group, where intervention is not given to a particular group. You observe them a period of time. Then at a particular point of time, you stop them. Then you switch over the treatments. For example, treatment A receives, this is, for example, group A, group B. So you have given chlorhexidine to one group and listerine to group B. You observe them a period of time. At one point of time, you switch on the treatments. For group A receives listerines and group B receives chlorhexidine. And you compare the outcomes. So this type of study design is called as crossover. You're crossing over the treatments within the group, or you're crossing over the intervention within the group. That is called as your crossover study designs. Fine. And the period before you start off crossing over is known as washout period. Okay. You wait for a period before you switching over the treatments is called as washout period. Because usually it is done for pharmacological or drugs, where if you want one, for example, if you're administering one particular drug, there'll be some residual effects of the drug inside your body. So you need to completely eliminate the residual effects. For that, you wait for a particular period of time based on the drug. Sometimes it will be 1 week, 2 weeks, or more than that. After that, then you administer the next drug to the other group. So the advantage of this crossover is the same group acts as its own control. It means the both the intervention or the both the drugs have been received by the same group. So you don't need an additional control for comparing between two drugs. So that is the advantages of this crossover design. So you have a concurrent parallel design. That is how a conventional RCTs is bidden. Then you have your crossover designs. Clear? Now let's solve some questions. We'll just see how much you have understood the short sessions. So this was a question which has been asked in your recent NEET 2020. Fine. So the group of people, so you can just comment on your chat box the answers. The group of people enrolled for a study on random basis remains in the same group till study completes. So what type of study design is this? Yeah, some people have come up with the answers. Yeah, somebody has asked about a bias. I'll just mention about a bias in your RCTs. Fine. So usually in bias, three types of bias, many types, there are more than 100 types of bias happens in your randomized control trials. So here we do a procedure called as blinding, clear blinding to avoid biases. So the three types of blinding are being done. That is a single blind, double blind, and triple blind. In single blind, the subject, that is the individual to which this intervention or the procedure or the drug has been given, is being blinded. That is, he does not know that whether he is in a case control group or a reference or a treatment group. Next is your next type of blinding. What you do is you're both the subject and your observer, or the investigator are blinded because they does not know to which part or which group they actually falls. And the third is, apart from your subject, the investigator, the statistician or the person who analyzed also are blinded, and they does it, three of them doesn't know that which group they actually fall. So that is single, double, and triple blinding. That is done to avoid bias in your RCTs. Clear? Here, see, here the answer is a little confusing. Answers are there because RCT, definitely RCTs, and you can see option B, C are both two designs of RCTs. Clear? Definitely this is an RCT, but a group of people enrolled for the study on random basis remains in the same group till study completes. Clear? So that is more towards a concurrence parallel design. So here RCT is the study design. RCT has two study design. One is a concurrent and crossover. So they specifically say that the study subject remain in the same group till study complete. So if you just can remember the study design we just saw earlier, the last slide, last to last slide, we just see the design here. They randomly assign into two groups, studied over a period of time. The groups does not change. The intervention does not change. They remain in the same groups, concurrent parallel study designs. Whereas in crossover, it does not happen. It changes. So there is a shift or swift between both the groups in terms of treatment. The first groups refer, for example, the first group gets chlorhexidine, second listerine, After a period of time, the first get Listerine, the second get chloroxin. So there is a switching over between the treatments. So that is called as crossover. So here, the best answer would be a concurrent parallel design. Clear? Both are designs, RCTs design, but the best answer would be concurrent parallel designs. Next, let's see the next question. The purpose of double blinding in clinical trial. What is the purpose of double blinding in clinical trial? Anyone? Can somebody? What is the purpose of double blinding in clinical trial? Yes, very good. Gayatri, Shubham, somebody with Redmi 6, all have come up with the answer. Yes, very good. So double blinding, as I told you, both the subject and observer, if they know that they are being a part of the study, they try to manipulate, they try to direct the study in different way. So that is why we always blind them. So subject, observer, and if the person analyzed or the statistician also are blinded, they are called as triple blinding. Fine. So they are triple blinding. So here the option is D, that is avoid observer and subject bias. No. Let's come to usually in public health dentistry, we don't come across pictorial questions so far. Very rarely we do come up. But let's try to get prepared for, because that is a new trend. That is all, everything comes in a pictorial way. You've been asked with pictures, clear? Pictures, so can you just solve what is above study design about? What is the study design? Very good, very good. Rahmat has answered, sir, yes. Yes, very good. It is your option C. That is your crossover study design. There is a crossing over between study subject, or there is a crossing over between subjects. Clear? Very good. Very good. And so that is all about your randomized control trials. If you have any doubts, I will clarify it. If you want me to repeat anything. Yeah, somebody has asked me with protocol. Yeah, see, protocol is the first step in designing your RCTs, that is your randomized control trial. Fine. So before you start off your study, you have to set guidelines. Yeah, it is simple as guidelines. You have a set note of guidelines in which you write and you decide what all things you are going to do. Fine. You have to very clearly set about your objectives and aims, because the most important reason why you should have a protocol in RCT, unlike your other study design, is there are a lot of ethical consideration when you come to our randomized control trials. Because you're doing something in the patient, you need to have an informed consent, you need to have ethical consideration. Unlike other study designs in analytical, you're just studying them. You're observing them and studying them. But whereas in a randomized control trial, you're doing something into the patient, you're making an incision, you're making an implant, you're doing an implant, or you're making, you're doing a rotary instrument. So you're doing something inside the patient's mouth. You need a consent of the patient, and you have to have ethical consideration. For that matter, a protocol stands very important. So you make an aim, you have set of the aim will be always one aim. You'll have a certain 3 to 4 objectives depending upon what all parameter you have to do in your study. Clear? Then what are things to be answered? What are the things to be addressed in your study? Say for what example, what we took was chlorhexidine and periodontitis. So what you have to select, what is the type of population you want? That is people with periodontitis. What is the, when do you call them to be periodontitis? Whether they should be included, or patients with any systemic diseases has to be excluded. Whether patients with drug history has to be excluded. So they all come under selection criteria. And intervention means the procedure itself, that is administering chlorhexidine. You're administering the chlorhexidine to the group. That is your experimental group. That is your intervention. Standardization is always training and calibration of your examiners. You train your examiners or investigators. That is your, when you do your research, it could be at your post-graduation level. It could be at your faculty level. You need to be trained to conduct the experiment. That is a basic knowledge. You have to be trained. How to hold the instrument, how to conduct the incision, how to hold the forceps, how to do the rotary instruments, every whatever the procedure it may be. That is your training. Calibration, all the instrument has to be calibrated for uniform reading. Otherwise, if it is not calibrated, every investigator, you know, every patient, you get different readings. And finally, you have to schedule when, where, how to do. And last, you have to evaluate. Is it clear, Dr. Shubham? Is it clear? Or you want me to again explain or any other points? Oh, good, good. Okay. Anything else to be added? Okay, fine. So that concludes today's session. If you have any doubts, you can comment on